I'm Thomas Mobat. I'm going to go over how to record some drums today. I'm going to go back to the basics and start with the drum kit and try to go through some of the elemental stuff with you and some microphones that I like to use. I'm going to assume that you have a basic understanding of miking up a drum kit, where to put mics, how to use stands, how to plug them in, and all that kind of stuff. So this is kind of more of an intermediate course for people that have mic'd up drum kits before. I'm going to go over some of the ways that I like to do it. I've been doing it a long time. I've been drumming since I was about 18 years old, actually earlier than that, maybe 13 or 14 on the drum kit. And I've been working in studios for about 35 years, so I've mic'd up a lot of drum kits, and I've seen a lot of guys do it their way, lots of different ways to go about it. Multiple mic situations, everything from one or two mics all the way up to 13, 14, 15. Sky's the limit. You can really go to town on putting on microphones on a drum kit. I'm going to try to make this course a little unique. I know there's a lot of videos out there how to mic up drum kits. There's hundreds of them probably. So I'm going to try to be a little bit more unconventional about it and not like I said, I'm going to assume that you know some of the basics and you're looking for something a little different here. I'm definitely the guy if you want to do things a little bit unconventionally. If you don't have a huge recording studio, you are in a tight budget, you've got a limited microphone selection, I understand that, and I've been there, and I'm still there. I don't have a huge $1 million room to record drums in. That would be nice, but then you've got to pay the bills on that as well. I'd rather operate fast and cheap and get a lot more musicians in there than have a beautiful world-class studio that's empty month after month. As I know a lot of them are these days. There's some really great world-class sounding rooms that are going empty because they have such a high overhead, they can't keep their prices competitive with us smaller guys. So don't feel like because you've got a small recording studio that you can't be very competitive and sound great. You absolutely can. A lot of these bigger places are struggling. They're going out of business. I get calls all the time. The guys are wondering how I'm still in business. I've been doing business here in Hawaii over 20 years now, and I've been recording professionally as an audio engineer for, like I said, about 35 years. And I'm still going. I'm not getting rich, but I am working with musicians and bands and artists every week. I won't say every day, but certainly every week I'm getting several different artists in. And we do drums a lot. People are really surprised when they realize that there's a drum kit ready to go, mic'd up in this little room. That's one of the nicest things about this studio is that I've always got a drum kit ready and mic'd up. And actually all I've got to do is turn on the mixing board and arm the channels in my DAW. And I'm pretty much ready to go in about 5 minutes. One other thing I'll mention just about how to address people. If I use the word, when I'm talking about engineers or producers, I tend to use the word he a lot. So forgive me if I do that. I'll try to include he or she or them or they as possible. But forgive me if I default to using the word he for engineers or producers. I mean no offense by that. I typically use about 10 to 12 microphones depending on the room and how many room mics I'm using. I can hear this snare buzzing a little bit, so I'm going to turn that off. It's one thing snares always do is they buzz. So little tip I'll go over later how to keep that from happening when you've got more than one snare drum in the room that you're auditioning. But right now I'm just going to turn off the snare. I'm going to start by showing you a few different microphones that I've used in the past and some of the ones that I'm leaning on more heavily these days. You'll have to excuse me if I'm a little sweaty today. I am in a drum booth and we have air conditioning in here, but I typically turn it off when recording. Air conditioning is something that you can definitely hear when you've got a whole bunch of microphones on your drum kit. So it tends to get a little bit hot in the drum booth. And what I'll do is between takes, I'll open the door and encourage the drummer to come in and listen back to a playback. And that'll give the room a chance to air out, get some oxygen in the room. But when I'm actually recording drums, I keep the door shut and the air conditioner and any fans off. So it's a little bit of a sweaty job, but drummers are usually used to that. I'm going to be a little sweaty here today myself, a little shiny, so forgive me. And I also have a big air conditioner in this room. I don't know if you can see it in the back there, but I can turn that on and get the room nice and cold on hot days. I'll get it like an ice box, keep the door shut, and then turn it off right before we start recording. So the drummer is basically sitting in a refrigerated room, and that's pretty nice too. But you've got to have a nice big air conditioner that can cool the room down quickly, as opposed to a small one that keeps the room cool consistently, because you got to turn that off. So I got a huge air conditioner that I can turn on and get the room freezing cold really quickly. It's wall mounted, and I've got a baffle over it to keep extraneous noise from getting in from the outside through the air conditioner. That's the one weak link in the chain, is that AC unit. So you got to build a little baffle around it to eliminate that. Everything from car horns and motorcycle traffic to, in Hawaii we have koki frogs at night, which are really loud. Also lawnmowers, things like that going by, roosters, dogs, that'll keep that from getting into your drum booth. Drums are pretty loud. It's not like you're recording a soft vocal or an acoustic guitar. So you can get away with a little bit more ambient noise, like squeaky drum stools, when you're got a full drum kit going. Nobody's gonna notice that in the mix unless it's a really quiet passage. Most of the time, drummers are playing really loud and you can, you're not going to hear little stuff, but a consistent air conditioner noise or fan noise like that, you're definitely going to hear that in your overheads and whatnot. So a little bit later, I'll go around the room and show you some of the ways that I've acoustically treated the room, not for cheap, but from some very inexpensive ways that I can not break the bank padding the room. I don't have a big, large drum booth or drum room. I'm restricted to getting great drum sounds in a small booth. But the more I look around, I'm seeing that a lot of studios are doing that. A lot of studios go for a small, acoustically dead or almost dead booth, and then they use artificial reverbs to generate the sound of the big room. You can always add more room with those artificial reverberation units, but you can't take away a sound of a big room. It's really hard to get that. So if you're recording in a big room, it's a lot harder to make it sound like you're not. If you're recording in a small room, it's a little easier to make it sound like you're recording in a larger environment, especially with some of the great chambers and room simulating plugins that we have these days. There's some really amazing stuff out there that if you've got a small room, you can make it sound like a world-class recording studio or a huge chamber or, you know, any number of different things like that. So we'll go into that a little bit more later when we go back into the booth, and I'm going to show you how to operate the console. So we're going to kind of hop back and forth between working on the drum kit in here where the microphones are and the drummer is, and then jumping out to the recording studio control room where we've got obviously the mixing board, and I've got my computer out there recording. So we're going to hop back and forth. I'm going to show you both sides of the glass today. What I do have here is a nice classic old drum kit. This is a 1967 Ludwig drum kit. It's pretty much a Ringo Starr drum kit, a four-piece drum kit with a kick, snare, tom-tom, a floor tom, and then in recent years, I've added the largest floor tom that I could find. Still, it's not the same same year, but it's a very similar drum, a large floor tom. So I have two nice big floor tom-toms down here, a great rack tom, and a snare and a kick drum. So this is a 67 Ludwig kit, Ringo Starr kit, and it sounds great. It's not so great on a lot of pop and reggae music, real snappy, funky stuff. This is more of a rock drum kit. If you want to think about guys like Ringo Starr, John Bonham played Ludwig. I think Charlie Watts from the Stones, he was playing a Gretsch kit, but very similar sounding kits, old vintage kits, smaller drum kits, pretty modern cymbals on here, in addition to some older Zildjian cymbals that are actually some of the oldest instruments I own. Some of those cymbals I've had since I was a teenager, and they're really dark and they sound great, and they're still taking a beating. But more recently, I've got it into some pasty cymbals. This is a little Zildjian splash I use, a nice pasty rude ride. I've got a lot of guys that love that, the power of that. A pasty rude crash over here. But anyway, I swap cymbals out all the time. I don't have any particular one brand that I stick to. Typically, I'll use a medium to thin crash up here. Often, I'll have a big old larger crash over here on my right side. Right now I've got a small 14-inch crash ride, which is kind of unconventional, but that's nice over there to crash it. And then a huge, powerful Rude ride. This is a 22-inch pasty 3000 Rude ride that cuts through just about anything. If that cymbal doesn't cut through, it's probably too loud. The band is playing too loud. So that's probably the most obnoxious cymbal I've ever seen. I saw Stuart Copeland playing that, and I just had to grab one. If you've heard cymbals played by Stuart Copeland, he really rides a lot on that bell, which is one of the things that I really liked about this cymbal. I've got some lighter and more jazzy and rock sort of rides over here, Zildjian rides, that I use probably more than I do this one, but I've got this one out today as well. So I almost forgot to mention the snare. I do have the original snare from this drum kit, which is a six inch, I think it's birch wood. Anyway, it's a 6-inch Ludwig 1967 snare that came with this kit. It's the original. I love it a lot. It's a big, great sounding snare. It's great on heavy rock and stuff. I have a Yamaha Maple Custom on here today. It's a little bit more of a modern sound. And I love it. You can get a nice, thick, dark, deep snare out of it. Or if you tune it up a little more tightly, it's a great pop and reggae kind of snare. We get a lot of that in Hawaii, where people want a little more snap to the snare. I just found that old Ludwig, that 6-inch, was not quite doing it. It was a little bit more military sounding, a little bit more, like I said, a little more rock and roll, older rock and roll kind of sound, which is not always what I'm going for. It had more of a vintage sound. And this snare, this Maple Custom, I haven't met any drummer that doesn't love this. They're a little bit dubious when I whip it out, and they're like, oh man, that's the best sounding snare I've ever heard. So they're expensive, but I recommend getting at least one or two really nice snares. Go ahead and spend a little extra money and get something that's really good. There's some great sounding snares out there, but the kick and the snare are sort of the heartbeat and the backbone of your drum kit, and it's important to get those sounding great, especially the snare. The kick, there's a lot of things you can mess around with to get that sound. It's easy to sample it. It's a trigger and sample with that. Padding and stuff. You got to have a great sounding kick drum, but I don't think the kick drum itself is that important as compared to the snare. I think the snare really is the one that's going to cut through and people are going to notice the most. Oh yeah, the hi-hat. My hi-hat is also one of the older cymbals that I've owned. I like this it's just an old dark, I don't even know the numbers on it. It's an old Zildjian hi-hat. It sounds great. I like the pasty hi-hats too. They're a little bit pricey, like the pasty 2002s. They're great, but I've got these on here today. So like I said, I switched this out a lot from Zildjian's, older darker sounding Zildjian's to more brighter, powerful sounding pasties and whatnot. And my little trusty Splash. Gotta have one of those. I do have a China over here. I'm not gonna talk just about cymbals today, but I do have a nice China, which is often over here if you want a quick crash on that side. Starting on the first channel, I usually put my kick drum. I'll typically put two microphones on the kick drum, one inside the kick a little bit and one more out in front of the kick by a few inches. The inside microphone is a little more clicky, a little bit more punchy, and the outside microphone has a little bit more woof and air to it, a little bit more of the room, of course, and you're also going to get more bleed into that microphone. I'll go over a way that I use to keep that from happening, so you can isolate that front mic, that mic that's out front, a little bit more. But we'll go over that later. I'm going to go over some of the basics now, and then as we get into it, I'll give you some more of my personal tips and tricks that I've picked up over the years to do it better. What I started on back in the day in my kick drum was a microphone from AKG. You've probably seen this before. It's called a D112. It looks a little bit like a football or a strange Easter egg. Pretty affordable microphone. I think they go for about $300. And they sounded great. You put them about just a few inches inside the front of the kick drum. If you've got the head off, that's easy. Or if you've got a front head, I usually cut a little hole in there to get the microphone in just a few inches inside the kick drum. You don't have to get it too far back in there. And that'll get a very nice, pleasing, well-rounded drum microphone sound, a lot of attack from the beater, as well as a lot of punch and woof from the rest of the drum. I'll go a little bit more into how I pad the drum down, how I baffle the drum inside to make it a little bit more studio-like and a little less ringy. But this is the mic I used for years. This was preceded by another mic from AKG, which is a very old company. A lot of people don't know much about AKG, but they've been around forever. Their first dynamic microphone was the D12. It was a famous little mic. I've talked about it before. It was the first dynamic microphone they produced, and I think it was the first dynamic microphone anybody ever produced. Before that, they were using coils and springs and stuff like that, and I think it had to have some kind of power. But anyway, this microphone came after that. The D12 is still available. They're great on other instruments besides the kick drum. If you put them on a bass cabinet or a guitar cabinet, they're wonderful microphones. They're a little more expensive than the D12. That's what most guys like about these, is they can pick up one of these for about, like I said, about $300, and I think that price is right. Let me check on that. And then you're good to go. You've got a kick drum microphone that's going to last for years. I've had this one, geez, I can't even remember, maybe 25, 30 years I've had this microphone, and it's great. There's nothing wrong with it. It works great. That's what I started off with. This is the front of the mic with the plastic rubbery green protector cap there. That goes towards the enemy. And then the back side, you've got a series of air vents on the back. People ask me what those are for, and I'll tell them that it's where the diesel exhaust fumes come out. That's the exhaust port for the capsule. And I say that with a straight face, and I always get bewildered looks from my clients when I say that. So it's always fun in the studio. Got to keep people on their toes. That's not really where the exhaust comes out. It's not really a diesel-powered microphone at all. It's actually no power required. This does not require phantom power. You just plug it in and you're good to go. Use that for years. The next microphone up that we see here is a famous one I've talked about also in previous videos. It's the Shure SM57. One of my all-time favorite microphones. I think it's everybody's all-time favorite microphone, except for maybe a 58. I don't use 58s on the drum kit for some reason. They're very identical to these, and you can use 58s as you may well please, but the 57 is the one we see on the snare all the time. It's kind of like peas and carrots. The snare drum and the 57 go together, and guys will usually mount them in kind of like that. I've got it right next to my Audix microphone, which I'm going to talk about in a second, but coming in at about a 30-35 degree angle from the side, couple inches in, you put it in too far, it's going to get smacked by the drummer. But I'll keep it back out of harm's way over there, or even put it, if somebody's really wailing, you can put it completely out of the way and almost under the hi-hat. Be careful you don't start getting hi-hat bleed into that microphone. That's something I'll talk about a little bit also, but right now we're just talking about the microphones. So that was the mic I used for years. I still use it, and it's a great snare drum microphone. Also a dynamic microphone, does not require any power of any kind. One little trick I give guys is if they're worried about their microphones getting damaged, especially their snare drum microphone, what you can do is take an old drumstick and make it about the same length of the mic like that, whatever mic you're using, and then saw it off right below there. And then you can take that piece of wood, that stick, and tape it. You can use duct tape if you want, or painter's tape, masking tape, and just tape it to the microphone, kind of like that. Maybe just a little bit out in front of it. Okay, and then tape that really securely to the microphone, and then mount it like that with the dowel or the stick. That way, if the drummer comes in and hits it, he's gonna be hitting the stick and not the microphone capsule, and that will probably save that microphone from destruction. It's transferring the brunt of that blow down into the tape and the body of the microphone and away from the capsule, which is basically made of plastic. So if he hits that plastic, it's certainly going to crack that. If he hits it really hard, it's probably going to destroy the capsule, and you're out of microphone. So that's a little trick that I have if you've got, especially for the heavy metal guys, the heavy rockers,
or, you know, you personally, if you're just a heavy hitter and you play blind, just put that out there and you won't have to worry about it so much. I can't tell you how many times that saved me in live situations too, where, you know, I've got a battle of the bands or something like that and 20 different drummers coming through, quick mic up. You don't know what's going on, so you know that'll keep that mic from getting damaged for you live guys. This is the Sennheiser 421. It's a classic old microphone. It's been around since dirt, and I think they were originally designed for announcers' mics, desktop announcers' mics. It's a very elegant-looking microphone. What these are usually seen on the drum kit are for tom-toms. You'll see them all the time, mounted like that. Typically coming in like that or some angle like that. And they were used on, they're still used on tom-toms around the world quite consistently. They're fantastic. They get a great tom-tom sound. They're pretty durable. If you do smack them, they're pretty robust. I've been lucky with this pair of them for a long time. But I found that they need a lot of EQ. When I'm mixing down, I found that the drums required a lot of dipping out of certain middle range frequencies to make them sound good. And I got a little bit tired of that, so I started going into some other microphones that I'll talk about here in a minute. But those are the Sennheiser 421s that we've seen for years on tom-toms. Not to get off track, but these are also great on electric guitar amplifiers and cabinets. What I'll usually do when I'm miking up an amp is put a Senn 421 as well as a Shure 57 very close together and very lined up. You don't want one out in front of the other. You want their capsules lined up. And be careful because the capsule in the 421 is back a little bit. You can see it if you look through there, but you want to line them up like that, not like that. You can see that in the monitor. Anyway, mount them together. One thing I've seen Andrew Sheps do is he actually duct taped a pair of them together just like that and just used them for snare drum, or for guitar amps. That way you're gonna not have any kind of issues with phase or anything like that. He just used it constantly like that. He put them dead center on the cabinet and right on the middle of the cone. He didn't angle them off or anything like that. Straight on, nice and close, and that was his. You got a lot of great guitar sounds that way, so I kind of picked up that technique from him. I don't tape them together like he does. I just put them very close together on the stand. As long as they're not too far apart or out of phase with each other, you'll be okay. Anyway, that's what we use, the Senn 421. They're great looking mics. I like using these still in percussion overdubs. I'll put a pair of them over a pair of bongos or congas or something like that. Really nice, pretty mic to look at too. I really like the way they look. Or if you're doing a podcast or interview or something like that, get a couple of little desk microphone stands and they look great for an interview or a podcast. We're so used to seeing the big Shure SM7B microphones. I'm sure you know the ones that every podcaster and his mother uses in podcasts. They're great announcers' mics, but I'm getting tired of seeing them. I'd prefer to see a more interesting mic like this in a podcast, and they sound great for voice. That's really what they were designed for, I think, initially, was voice. And the one difference between these, I don't know if you can see it or not, but there's a Sennheiser label on the front. One of them is black and one of them is silver. This is not a matched pair. They're a little bit different in shape there, too, at the butt. Anyway, interesting microphone. So let's see, that covers my kick, my snare, my tom-toms. Oh yeah, my overheads, a very important microphone. The mics that go over the kit, there's usually two of them. You can use three if you've got a big kit, but I always use two. That seems to work fine. The mics that come down from above, I've got these mics down lower than I usually do. I usually don't have them quite that close to the cymbal. Just for demonstration purposes today, I've got them really low so you can see them in the frame of the camera. Otherwise, they're off camera. This one over here, I usually kind of group them, obviously, to a left and a right side. When I say left and right, by the way, I mean my left as a drummer and my right. And I'll distinguish that in my notes. When I say left, I'll write left, hi-hat, right, ride. it's very important to distinguish that, because a lot of guys talk about their left and right from the front of the kit as the audience point of view, which would be the opposite, of course. But as a drummer, I always consider the left my hi-hat side, right my ride side, and I'll indicate that on my track sheets and in my DAW, so that guys don't flip them and have the overheads opposite the rest of the kit. Otherwise, it's just going to be a phasey mess of stuff, and you're not going to get that split, that nice separation, that stereo image that you want to get as the producer. But these microphones up here are coming down. You can change that to suit your different configurations, but usually I'll have them pointing either straight down like that, or a little bit apart like these kind of are, a slight angle. You don't want them too far apart like that, but kind of pointing at the areas that you want. You could also angle them in if you've got a big drum kit. You can come in from the outsides, but I usually kind of come in straight like that, or maybe a little bit of a split, a little bit of a spread like that. I aim them to certain areas. I usually have the left-hand microphone kind of pointing at the area of the hi-hat and crash cymbal, or cymbals if there's a few cymbals on this side, and then the same on this side. I'll have the ride, usually one or two crashes, or maybe a third crash over here on my far side. For me, I usually have a splash cymbal right here in the middle, which I removed today so you can see what I'm doing, but usually I have a little splash right there. So you kind of want to have them in your left and right groups of cymbals. If you've got cymbals in the middle, those will get picked up as well, but kind of think of them as picking up certain areas of the drum. They're going to get your hi-hat. Obviously, your snare is probably going to appear right in the center. It's something you kind of want to think about is having, if you can imagine a point from the center of your snare going to each of the microphones, that distance should be pretty equal, like an equilateral triangle. You don't want to have one mic being way far back, so that snare is taking longer to get to that. It's going to create a strange little bit of a phase cancellation there, so watch out for that. I know certain guys will actually measure the distance between the center of the snare, and each mic with the measuring tape to make sure that that's very accurate. I'm not quite that meticulous with it yet, but maybe as I get older, I will be. But right now, as long as that snare is appearing right in the center, you're golden. The microphones that I used for years were from one of my favorite microphone companies called Rode. They've been around for a long time now, and they're one of the first microphone companies that made expensive looking and sounding microphones at very reasonable prices. Rode has been making great quality mics for years. I'm actually using one today for the video. This little microphone I have here and the pack is a Rode lavalier pack. I think it's called the Rode Go 2. Anyway, I've got some of those for my interviews. I've got one here just off screen. Let's see if I can pull that in a little bit. Yeah, that's my video mic up there for my voice. That's a Rode video mic. I think that's called the NTG. Anyway, I got to check on that, but I've been using that for a while now in my videos. It's a great, great lightweight microphone for videos. This pair of microphones is the Rode NT5. I got a matched pair, the Rode NT5. They're little condenser microphones, or they're also called pencil microphones. They require phantom power. They're very lightweight and very easy to handle. You can get them in really tight situations. It was really my first matched pair of microphones, and I got them specifically for overheads, and I used them for a long time. They worked great. They still work great. They can also be used in other areas. I've used these as field recorders a lot. You take a matched pair of these out in the field and get nice stereo images. They're great on, you can drop one on your hi-hat or your ride, which I'm going to talk about in a second. You can use them on acoustic guitars as a second mic on acoustic guitar, or even as your only mic on acoustic guitar if you want to do that. There's all kinds of applications for this pair of, it's a very versatile pair of condenser microphones that I think was about $300 or $400 when I bought them as a matched pair. I think that price holds true. And there's a couple other condenser mics that Rode offers that are very similar to this microphone that you might want to look at as well. If you've enjoyed this video and would like to see more, please consider joining my recording studio forum. It's full of tips and tricks, as well as my personal advice on how to improve your studio and keep your clients happy and productive. Now, all my videos and tutorials will be in one convenient place, and any new material will be added there as it grows. I'm offering it all to you right now at a special early bird discount. I'm going to leave you some quick links to the products I've discussed, as well as the gear I use in my studio every single day. Mahalo for your kind support, and aloha from Hawaii.